Lord, may I request permission to commence the proceedings? I request respected Advocate General to deliver the service.
The Honorable the Chief Justice of Kerala, Justices Manikumar, the Honorable Justice P.V. Asha, the Honorable Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar, the Honorable Judges of the High Court of Kerala, the President of the Kerala High Court Advocate Association, Sri Thomas Abraham, the Chairman of the Bar Council of Kerala, Law Officers of the State, Assistant Solicitor General, Senior Standing, Central Standing Council, Taxes and other Law Officers of the Central Government, Senior Advocates, esteemed fellow members of the Bar, Registrar General, Registrars and Staff of the High Court, Staff of the Advocates General Office, Advocates Clerks, Srimati Sudha S. Kumar, wife of Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar, and Megha S. Kumar and Bhagya S. Kumar, His Lordship's daughters. Advocates, ladies and gentlemen, and all other dignitaries joining online. Today, we are bidding farewell to Justice P.V. Asha and Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar, demitting office on 31-5-2021 on attaining superannuation after illustrious judicial careers. Though with a pall of gloom, I may say that the occasion is also unique, since their lordships are the last to demit office from among the honorable six of the same proficient batch of the Government Law College, Ernakulam, who had adorned the office of the judges of Honorable Court, the others being Justice Retired V.K. Mohanan, Justice P.R. Ramachandra Menon, presently Chief Justice of the High Court of Chhattisgarh, Justice Retired C.K. Abdul Rahim, and Justice Retired A.M. Shafiq. Incidentally, His Lordship Justice P.R. Ramachandra Menon, Chief Justice of the High Court of Chhattisgarh, is also attaining superannuation on 31-5-2021. Justice P.V. Asha was born and brought up at Triprayar near Thrissur. After graduating from Vimala College, Thrissur, Her Lordship acquired law degree from Government Law College, Ernakulam, and enrolled as a lawyer in 1983. Her Lordship began practice at Irinyalakuda as junior to Advocate K.R. Thamban, and in the year 1985 shifted her practice to the High Court as junior to Senior Advocate M.R. Rajendran Nair. Her Lordship's practice was mostly in the High Court of Kerala and the Central and State Administrative Tribunals, and the area of practice were predominantly service, constitutional and civil matters. Literally wedded to law, Her Lordship, even from her initial days as a lawyer, was known for her hard work and meticulous preparation of briefs. Recognizing her lawyering skills, the state government appointed Her Lordship as a senior government pleader at the High Court of Kerala for the period from 1996 to 2001. I, as the state prosecutor, was also a part of the SAT team of state law officers. As state law officers, we had occasions to interact with each other in the matter of conduct of cases, and I had the opportunity to have first-hand experience of the legal acumen of Her Lordship. Her Lordship, on account of her outstanding performance, was held in high esteem as a state law officer by the government officials and the bar alike. Her Lordship was standing counsel for various statutory bodies and was also in the panel of lawyers to represent the Honorable High Court. Her Lordship was elevated as a judge of this Honorable Court on 21-5-2014. Her Lordship sat in the court with a disarming smile and was known for always being pleasant, polite and gentle in the court, while being firm and forthright in justice dispensation. No matter whatever is the outcome of a case, every lawyer who appeared before Her Lordship had no reason to be dissatisfied, insofar as Her Lordship always gave a patient hearing, never compelled any lawyer to wind up the submissions, and every argument raised by either side were dealt with in detail in the judgments. I am not saying that the media is the best judge of judges or judgments, but it's an instance worth mentioning when a judgment becomes topic for the editorial of a news daily, and its academic essence is discussed therein. any sensation deviating from the core issue involved in Her Lordship's judgment dated 12/4/2021 in writ petition civil number 8089 of 2021. The Secretary, Kerala Legislative Assembly versus the Union, the Election Commission of India. In the matter of conduct of elections to the Rajya Sabha seats from the state was hailed as a judgment upholding constitution by the editorial in the Matrubhumi Daily dated 13/4/2021. In Nijesh KK versus High Court of Kerala and others, 2016 5 KHC 874, Her Lordship, while asserting that the authorities were duty bound to see that a member of the scheduled caste was granted promotion giving him the benefit of temporary exemption from tax qualification, resonated the principles of affirmative action which the founding fathers of our constitution embodied in Article 16 and 46 therein. His Lordship judgment Ranjit JV versus and others versus State of Kerala and others 2020 5 KLK 324, which upheld the state government's decision to provide reservation to physically disabled in the jobs in government-aided private colleges and schools, is a torchbearer judgment in the matter of affirmative action in favor of physically disabled in government-aided institutions. Her Lordship, in Fahima Shirin Arkhe versus State of Kerala and others 2019 4 KHC 901, held that the right to have access to Internet was part of right to education as well as right to privacy under Article 21 of the Constitution, and struck down the restrictions imposed on usage of mobile phones in girls' hostel. At the time of her elevation, by which time 58 years had passed since the formation of the Kerala High Court, Her Lordship was the 11th woman judge of this Honourable Court and the second woman judge to be directly elevated from the bar. At the time of elevation of Her Lordship, it was a major news item in all media that two women were to hold office as judges of this Honourable Court at a single point of time. This Honourable Court will have four women judges now on Justice P.V. Asha attaining superannuation. But even four women judges is not reflective of the gender ratio of the state's population, wherein women outnumber men. In Madras High Court, 13 judges out of the present total strength of 60 judges are women, of which four have been directly elevated from the bar. This shows that the ratio of women judges as a whole and women judges directly elevated from the bar are comparatively lower in the High Court of Kerala. In my opinion, the High Court of a state wherein Renaissance movements attained its zenith more than a century ago and which gave India Srimati Dakshayani Velayudhan, the only Dalit woman member of the Constituent Assembly, Justice Anna Chandi, the first ever woman High Court judge, and Justice Fatima Bibi, the first ever woman Supreme Court judge, requires more women judges. To quote Justice D.Y. Chandrachud as he spoke at a farewell ceremony organized to honor Justice Indu Malhotra on her retirement, I quote, "Justice Malhotra's retirement means that the SC now has only one female judge on the bench. As an institution, I find that this is a deeply worrying fact and must promptly receive serious introspection. We must ensure the delivery of our diversity of our country find reflection in making up our court intrinsically having a more diverse judiciary is an end, a goal in itself and worth pursuing in its own side." Unquote. Hope that more women will adorn the august office of judge of this Honorable Court in the near future. Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar, who hails from Kidakan Muthur near Tiruvalla, His Lordship completed school education at Alua, Ernakulam, graduated in science from Union Christian College, Alua, and acquired a postgraduate degree in science from SSL Jain College, Vidisha, Madhya Pradesh. It was out of passion for law that His Lordship left a teaching assignment in Shimla to study law. His Lordship completed LLB from Government Law College, Ernakulam, and LLM from Mahatma Gandhi University. His Lordship enrolled as a lawyer on 2/4/1989. His Lordship's practice was mostly before this Honourable Court and the subordinate courts of Ernakulam in criminal and civil sites. His Lordship was selected as a District Sessions Judge and joined the judiciary on 1/12/2001, being appointed as an additional District Judge to Thiruvananthapuram. The almost 1.5 decade in Kerala Higher Judicial Service, His Lordship was additional District and Sessions Judge at Thiruvananthapuram, Kasargod and Kozhikode, was Enquiry Commissioner and Special Judge Vigilance Kozhikode, was Registrar Railway Claims Tribunal New Delhi, was Registrar of Supreme Court, and was Principal District and Sessions Judge Thiruvananthapuram in Thrissur. While administering the district judiciary as a principal district judge, His Lordship reportedly was all ears for personal grievances of lawyers and ever ready even to go an extra mile to find solutions for the same. Stood rock solid with the causes of the lawyering community and was very particular in attending to lawyers in crises. Lawyers at district court centers would recall numerous instances wherein His Lordship, while being the principal district judge, would call up the doctors and authorities hospital in which lawyers were admitted to make sure that the best treatment was made available to them. No wonder His Lordship attained an iconic stature among members of the Thiruvananthapuram Bar, wherein His Lordship spent more than 6.5 years out of about 14.5 years of service in the subordinate judiciary. His Lordship was elevated as a judge of this Honourable Court on 10/4/2015. His Lordship's capacity for hard work and ever-readiness to delve into the details of a case requires special mention. His Lordship's thorough knowledge of judicial precedents, particularly in criminal jurisprudence, is unparalleled. That nearly six crores of reportable judicial precedents were rendered either by His Lordship or by benches of which His Lordship was a party is an eloquent testimony for the volume of judicial work put in by His Lordship during his tenure as a judge of this Honourable Court. His Lordship's concern for the convenience of the lawyers found expression in the order rendered within 1 month of His Lordship's elevation by a bench of which His Lordship was also a party in Sunny versus State of Kerala 2015, 3 KHC 946. The bench took note of the inconveniences faced by the lawyers in the publication of weekly final hearing lists only on Mondays and issued necessary orders. In Nizamuddin A versus Station House Officer Kannur Town Station and another 2017 3 KHC 790, His Lordship traced the meaning, scope and object of the words keeps in bondage in Section 79 of the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection Children Act 2015. In Santosh Kumar versus State of Kerala, His Lordship took cognizance of the delay in delivering orders on bail applications in subordinate criminal courts and necessary directions were issued. Their Lordship Justice P.V. Asha and Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar can retire from judiciary with full satisfaction that they have rendered absolute justice to the constitutional and judicial responsibilities obligated from them. On behalf of the entire lawyer fraternity of the state, I extend my best wishes to my lords to have many more years of happy, creative and fruitful lives. I also extend best wishes to Srimati Sudha S. Kumar, wife of Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar, and Megha S. Kumar and Bhagya S. Kumar, His Lordship's daughters, who are present with us today. I remain, thank you all.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Sir Thomas Abraham, President, Kerala High Court Advocates Association, to deliver the farewell speech.
Honorable Chief Justice, Mr. Justices Manikumar, Honorable Srimati Justice P.V. Asha, and Honorable Mr. Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar, other Honorable Judges, family members of Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar, Advocate General Mr. K. Kovar Shukuru, Additional Advocate General Mr. K. K. Ravindranath, Director General of Prosecution Mr. T. A. Shahji, Assistant Solicitor General Mr. P. Vijay Kumar, State Attorney Mr. K. V. Sohan, Sri Joseph John, Chairman Bar Council of Kerala, respected elder members of the fraternity, the Registrar General and other officers of this court, advocate clerks, and dear friends. Bidding farewell to four judges within a fortnight is indeed sorrowful for all of us. It was only a few days back that this court hall witnessed the farewell references of Justice A. Hariprasad and Justice T. V. Anilkumar. Now when Justice P. V. Asha and Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar also joined them, the void created by their absence makes us feel the heavy loss. There is a speciality for this occasion. That two classmates are waving goodbye to us together is that speciality. It is interesting to find that they are part of the six-member team of classmates who became judges of this Honorable Court one after the other. As all of you know, the other four judges are Justice V.K. Mohanan, Justice C.K. Abdul Rahim, Justice P.R. Ramachandra Menon, and Justice A.M. Shafiq. Justice P.V. Asha hails from Nattiga in Thrissur district. She graduated from Bimla College, Thrissur before obtaining law degree from Government Law College, Ernakulam. After her enrollment in 1983, she began practice at Irinjalakuda as a junior to advocate K.R. Thamban. She later shifted practice to Ernakulam and was attached to the office of senior advocate M.R. Rajendran Nair till 1996. She served as a senior government printer during 1996 to 2001 and later set up independent practice and specialized in service, constitutional and civil laws. She became the 11th woman judge to adorn the bench and the second woman judge elevated from the bar. The sound service lawyer in Sri Justice P.V. Asha underwent the transformation into an authority in all branches of law she dealt with. That was what this bar witnessed after a short period of her taking charge as a judge of this Honorable Court. Every member of this bar would recollect her soft and polished manners, even during occasions of creating stress and strife. Her Lordship's judgments contain unwritten lines declaring her passion for maintaining grandeur of the high judicial office held by her. In Fahima Shireen R.K. versus State of Kerala and others reported in 2019, 4KLT301, where a student approached this Honorable Court aggrieved by her expulsion from the hostel for refusing to comply with the restrictions sought to be imposed regarding the use of mobile phones. Justice Asha observed that when the Human Rights Council of the United Nations have found that the right to access to internet is a fundamental freedom and a tool to ensure right to education, a rule of instruction which impairs the said right to the students cannot be permitted to stand in the eye of law. In Jaslin Jose A. versus Kuchinpur Trust and another, reported in 2019-1 KLT-298, Her Lordship observed that women, as defined in Section 3O of the Maternity Benefit Act 1961, would include one engaged on contract basis also, and directed that the petitioner be paid the salary due to her for the period for which she requested for maternity leave. Justice P.V. Asha will always remain as a source of impetus for the youngsters of this bar, as she is a self-made person who entered the portals of this court through her hard work and dedication to her profession. The bar is proud to have a large number of women lawyers who are deeply committed to the profession. Justice P.V. Asha is certain to remain as a lodestar guiding them in their path of success. Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar obtained his law degree from Government Law College, Ernakulam, and his LLM degree from Mahatma Gandhi University, Kottayam. After his enrollment in 1989, his lordship practiced for several years before this Honorable Court and the subordinate courts in Ernakulam before entering the Kerala Higher Judicial Service as a district and sessions judge in 2001. His lordship served as an additional district judge, Thiruvananthapuram, Inquiry Commission Special Judge Vigilance, Connecticut, before being appointed as a Registrar, Supreme Court of India. After rendering exceptional service in various roles in the next few years, His Lordship was appointed as a judge of this Honorable Court. While perusing His Lordship's contribution in the area of judicial precedence, I was really wondering as to how I can choose the best among the several, as each one of them I felt worth mentioning in this speech. Considering the invisible borders of time, which I am not supposed to infringe, with His Lordship's permission, I confine to a few of his judgments alone. In Santosh Kumar versus State of Kerala, reported in ILR 2019-3, Kerala 792, taking note of the fact that the magistrate had taken 22 days to dispose of a bail application, Justice B. Sudhir Kumar had observed that it is imperative that the criminal courts must deliver orders on the bail applications on the date of hearing itself or on the next day, subject to the rider that the bail applications must be normally disposed of within 1 week from the date of filing of the same. In Roy, Compton Roy versus State of Kerala, and another reported in 2019-3 KLT 1090, noting that the provisions of the code, in particular section 57 and 167, manifest the legislative anxiety that once a person's liberty has been interfered with by the police arresting him without a court order or a warrant, the investigation must be carried out with utmost urgency and completed within the maximum period for allowed by Proviso 8 to Section 167(2) of the Code. Justice Sudhir Kumar held that the accused has indefeasible right to get default bail under Proviso to Section 167(2) of the Code if the investigation is not complete within the statutory period. In Shivadasinam v. State of Kerala, and another report in ILR 2063-KER-81, while considering a revision petition challenging the concurrent fighting of conviction and sentence passed by the courts below under Section 497 IPC, His Lordship observed that there is no reason for the complainant to be aggrieved after having obtained divorce and remarried, and held that the husband of the woman alone shall be deemed to be aggrieved by the offence under Section 497 IPC and not the former husband. There may be 1,000 beautiful words to pay the regards of this bar to Justice Sudhir Kumar, but the bar would prefer to see His Lordship as a good Samaritan who came in search of the mentally perturbed and physically injured lawyers in connection with the incidents in 2016, following a tussle with the section of the press and consequent police atrocities. That feeling of oneness His Lordship revealed from his innermost heart will always remain as an evergreen memory among us. We, the members of the bar, bid your lordships, Justice P.V. Asha and Justice B. Sudhir Kumar, farewell and wish good health and long life to continue your valuable service to the nation. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Honorable the Chief Justice to deliver the farewell speech.
Honorable Sister Justice P.V. Asha, Honorable Brother Justice Sudhinder Kumar, my esteemed brother and sister judges, Honorable retired judges of this court who are witnessing this event, Mr. Gopala Kurup, Krishna Kurup, Learned Advocate General, Mr. P.K. Ravindranath Menon, Learned Senior Standing Counsel and Government of India Taxes, Mr. K.K. Ravindranathan, Learned Additional Advocate General, Mr. K.V. Sohan, Learned Attorney General, State Attorney, Mr. T.S. Haji, Director General of Prosecutions, Mr. M.N. Suganabalan, who is not present here, Learned Senior Advocate and President of the Senior Advocates Association, Mr. Joseph John, Chairman, Bar Council of Kerala, Mr. Vijay Kumar, Learned Assistant Solicitor General of India, Mr. Thomas Abraham, President of the Kerala High Court Advocates Association, Srimathi S.K. Devi, President of the Kerala Federation of Women Lawyers, respected senior lawyers, my dear junior friends, Registrar General and other registrars of this court, family members of Justice P.V. Asha, Srimathi Sudha S. Kumar and other family members of Justice Sudhinder Kumar, staff of this court, members of the Advocates Clerks Association, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon to all. When the legal fraternity was happy to receive 5 permanent judges in the forenoon, Honorable Justice P.V. Asha and Honorable Justice P.V. B. Sudhinder Kumar are demitting their office on attaining superannuation.
Perhaps it may be a rare occasion when two honorable judges of this court are demitting their office on the same day, 31st May 2021. And perhaps it is also a memorable day when the classmates are retiring today. After obtaining a law degree from the Government Law College, Ernakulam, Sister Justice Asha enrolled as an advocate in the year 1983 and commenced her practice in the subordinate courts at Irinjala Kuda under the guidance of late Mr. K. R. Thamban, an eminent lawyer. In 1985, Justice Asha shifted her practice to Ernakulam and joined the office of advocate Mr. M. R. Rajendra Nair and continued her till her appointment as senior government pleader in 1996. She functioned as senior government pleader till 2001. Thereafter, she set up her independent practice in 2001, and her main area of concentration was service law. Recognizing her hard work and dedication, Sister Justice Asha was elevated to the bench of this court as an additional judge on 21-5-2021. She has the distinction of a second woman judge from the bar, and I am informed that it is after a long interval of almost a quarter of a century, 23 years to be precise. She was made as a permanent judge on 20th May 2016. As a judge of this court for 7 years, Justice Asha has disposed of 13,986 cases single bench, 3,005 cases division bench, and 9 cases full bench, totaling 17,000 cases. Justice Asha has delivered many landmark judgments on various subjects, some of which are spoken to by the Learned Advocate General and the President of the Advocates Association. Mainly, one issue I think I wanted to say, in this particular case, Fahima Shireen, Justice Asha has considered right to privacy, right to education, and right of women empowerment all in one single decision. This is how the judge can take an issue multidimensionally. I just wanted to say about one incident. When I had my first training, I should say legal education training at the National Academy of National Academy at Bhopal, someone was asking about what is judgment. Justice Sinha was explaining that a judgment is trying to resolve the disputed rights between two parties. So he said judgment can be written only for that particular purpose. Okay, how to resolve the dispute between two parties? First of all, we must understand what is the right. Okay, right you have to understand, then I think you can resolve the dispute. Then he said judgment can be written as a precedent. In case if there is no judgment on that issue, it can be written as a precedent. Well, the third thing he said, the judgment can be written for the social values contained in the subject which you are dealing with. Exactly, Honorable Justice Asha has dealt with the social issues in that particular matter in respect of right to privacy, right to women empowerment, right to advancement of education, all in one. So that's how a multidimensional view of a judge in considering an issue. The learned judge who was there in the meeting also said, the judgment can be purposed for governance. I think you can see one judgment in Vishakha, though there is no rule or something like that, it was for governance. And I sincerely feel Justice Asha has written a well-considered judgment on all these issues in this particular one case, Fahima versus Shireen. Now, there are other judgments relating to as to whether a woman who is engaged on contract basis is entitled to maternity leave with full pay or not. That in Jesslyn Jose reported in 2019, 1 KLT 298, after traversing through the provisions of the Maternity Benefit Act and various decisions of the Honorable Supreme Court, Justice Asha held like this. Woman as defined in Section 3O of the Act would include one engaged on contract basis also. You see how she has put it like this. Don't distinguish between a contract and a non-contractual. Woman is a woman. So thus, she has rendered several judgments ventilating the grievances of the weaker sections of the society and the have-nots. On the administrative side, Sister Justice Asha has served as a member of several committees, such as the Committee for Arrears of Subordinate Courts and Service Matters for the Ministerial Staff, Committee to Attend the Grievance on Welfare Measures of the Former Judges and Family Members, Committee for Recruitment of Munsifs and Magistrates, Committee for Sensitization of Family Court Matters. She has also served as Board of Governors of the State Kerala Mediation and Conciliation Center. With my little experience with the learned judge, I have no hesitation to say that Justice Asha has worked very hard ventilating the grievances of the public, both on the administrative and judicial side. From my personal experience, I shall portray Sister Justice Asha as a very soft person, bold and determined, whose words and actions openly reflect the intrepid nature of her approach. Her addition in domain of the service laws had produced several notable judgments, left indelible imprints in the judicial arena. Now, about my brother Justice P. Sudhindra Kumar. Due to his keen interest in law and desire to serve public in a different capacity, after quitting a teaching job in Shimla, Justice B. Sudhindra Kumar joined Government Law College, Ernakulam, and obtained law degree. Thereafter, he took LLM from Mahatma Gandhi University, Kottayam. After enrollment, he started his legal practice in Ernakulam under the guidance of Mr. P. Jacob Varghese, an eminent lawyer. When great lawyers have contributed their legal acumen and knowledge to the advancement of justice delivery system, a few desire that they can also do so if they are in office, and thus Justice Sudhindra Kumar joined Kerala Higher Judicial Service as a directly recruited district and session judge and appointed as the additional district judge, Thiruvananthapuram, on 1/12/2001. Thereafter, he had functioned as the vigilance special judge, Kozhikode. In 2006, Justice Sudhindra Kumar was selected and appointed on deputation as the registrar, Honorable Supreme Court of India, becoming the first person from this state to hold said post, which I would say a rare distinction to himself. Later, he served as additional district judge at Kasaragod and Kozhikode, subsequently served as the principal district judge, Thiruvananthapuram. He has also held the office of the registrar of the Railways Claims Tribunal, New Delhi. While functioning as the principal district judge, Thrissur, Sudhindra Kumar was elevated to the bench of this court as an additional judge on 10/4/2015 and appointed as permanent judge of the Kerala High Court with effect from 5/5/2017. As a judge of this court for 6 years, Justice Sudhindra Kumar has disposed of 16,867 single bench cases and 420 division bench cases, and thus a total number of 17,287 cases. Brother Justice Sudhindra Kumar has delivered many landmark judgments, some of which have been addressed by the Learned Council. I would only wish to add few. In Thangamani versus Vasanthi and others, reported in 2024 Kerala High Court cases, Justice Sudhindra Kumar considered an original petition filed against the dismissal of the prayer for remitting the Advocate Commission's report and sketch by the court below. After elaborate consideration of Section 75 and Order 26, Rule 9 of the Civil Procedure Code, and various decisions of this court, Justice Sudhindra Kumar explained as to how a commission's report has to be considered by the courts below. In Manisha versus Chatley, reported in 2017 to KLT, Justice Sudhindra Kumar considered the practice of the investigating agency disclosing to the public the statement given by the accused in the course of an investigation, particularly when the other accused were not arrested. Justice Sudhindra Kumar, after considering the statutory provisions, held that it is not a healthy practice. He further added that in order to have an effective investigation in a case, it is necessary to keep the materials received by the police themselves to avoid any sort of misguiding or tampering in the matter of investigation. A guidance to the police hitherto being followed. On the administrative side, Brother Justice Sudhinder Kumar has served as a member of the Budget Committee and Monitoring Committee for the schemes of subordinate courts. In my personal note, Justice Sudhinder Kumar never minced words in expressing his thoughts and views. On this occasion, I express my sincere regards and respect to the family members of Sister Justice Asha and also to Srimati Sudha S. Kumar, wife of Brother Justice Sudhinder Kumar, and other family members, and all those associated with the Honorable Judges in discharging their duties as judges of this court. While bidding farewell to Sister Justice Asha and Brother Justice Sudhinder Kumar, on behalf of my sisters and brothers on the bench and on my own behalf, I extend my deep gratitude for their unstinted support for administration of justice in this court. I take this opportunity to extend our best wishes for their continued good health and long, peaceful life. Thank you.
Thank you, Milord. May I now please invite Honorable Srimati Justice P.V. Asha for the place, please.
My Lord, the Honorable Chief Justice, Mr. Justice S. Manikumar, my esteemed brother and sister judges, Sri K. Gopalakrishna Kurup, the Advocate General, Sri Thomas Abraham, President of the Kerala High Court Advocates Association, Sri P. Vijayakumar, Assistant Solicitor General of India, Sri T. A. Shaji, the Director General of Prosecutions, Sri K. K. Ravindranath, Additional Advocate General, Sri P. K. Ravindranath Menon, Senior Standing Counsel, Government of India Taxes, Sri K. V. Sohan, State Attorney, Srimadi Molly Jacob, Representative from the Kerala Women Lawyers Federation, Srimadi S. K. Devi, President of the Kerala Women Lawyers Federation, Sri N. N. Suganabalan, President of Senior Advocates Association, Sri Joseph John, the Chairman, Bar Council of Kerala, former judges, law officers of the centre and state, senior advocates, my dear members of the bar, registrars, judicial officers, directors and additional directors of Judicial Academy, director of Kerala State Mediation and Conciliation Council, member secretary, Kerala State Legal Services Authority, members of the staff of the High Court, the advocate clerks, my dear friends, relatives, and all other ladies and gentlemen who are viewing this function offline and online. Good afternoon to one and all. At the outset, let me express my gratitude to the Honorable Chief Justice, the Learned Advocate General, and the Learned President of the High Court Advocates Association for the good words spoken about me, which I am fully conscious are much more than what I deserve. Every day when I come to my chamber, my name board kept reminding me of the wonderful plans of the God Almighty, whose blessings alone have guided me to the corridors of this great institution as a lawyer, and thereafter as a judge. It continues to be a mystery, at least for some of my childhood friends, who couldn't even accept my diversion to the field of law. With the grace of God, I am completing my tenure in this august institution, with the contentment that whatever little I have done has been in due compliance with the oath I had taken at the time of swearing, in letter and spirit. I am grateful to the collegium headed by Dr. Manjula Chellur, the then Chief Justice of this court, and the then collegium of the Honorable Supreme Court, and all those who were instrumental in giving me an opportunity to serve this institution. At this juncture, I remember with reverence late Advocate K.R. Thamban, under whom I started my practice at Irinyalakuda. I am indebted to Senior Advocate Sri M.R. Rajendra Nair, who molded my career and because of whom alone I got recognition as a lawyer of this court. My pranams to Senior Advocate late M.K. Damodaran, former Advocate General, under whose leadership I could gain experience as a senior government leader. I acknowledge my gratitude to Justice Kurian Joseph, former judge of this court and the Supreme Court, at whose inspiration alone I ventured to set up my independent practice. At the time of my elevation, the then Chief Justice Dr. Manjula Chellur was the only woman in the bench. Within less than 3 months, I became the sole woman judge for the next 8 months. But I was fortunate to have very affectionate brother judges, four of whom were my classmates, who took special care of me, and I never felt like a fish out of water. I am grateful to all my brother judges for this. I had the rare privilege to have 5 of my classmates as brother judges, and also to demit office along with my brother Justice Sudhindra Kumar, who is the 6th among us. I was fortunate to share the division bench headed by Justice T.R. Ramachandran Nair for about 11 months, whose guidance and encouragements helped me a lot in discharging my duties. All other brother and sister judges with whom I had opportunity to share division benches were also very considerate to me. I am grateful to the Honorable Chief Justice and all my affectionate brother and sister judges for their cooperation, guidance and assistance. I am also grateful to the respective presidents and members of the Board of Governors of the Kerala State Mediation and Conciliation Council for the period from 2019 onwards, who introduced me to the world of mediation. The future beholds the betterment of this institution as well as of the profession. I have found it necessary to motivate the youngsters, and especially the new entrants in the bar, to come well equipped for presenting any matter. It was a genuine pleasure for me to see some brilliant youngsters presenting their matters systematically. It was indeed a heartwarming experience for me while listening to the well-prepared and forcible arguments put forth by some of the young women lawyers. I wish them all the very best. There would have been instances when my words or deeds have hurt at least some of you in the bar or the members of the staff. If that be so, it was not intentional. I tender my apologies for the same. Without the diligent and dedicated service rendered by my private secretary Rehna T.R. and my personal assistant Rashmi K.C., I would not have been able to function. My court officer Vijayalakshmi has been very efficient and sincere in her duties. Mrs. Aishwarya and Vishi, my additional PAs, and Srimadi Dini, confidential assistant, were also industrious to complete the work in time. My research assistant Aishwarya Lakshmi and the office assistants, Mrs. Shiju, Krishnakumar and Reddy, were equally helpful. I thank all of them in abundance. I am grateful to Sri Vijayakumar, office assistant at my residence, whose sincere services made me comfortable. My gratitude is due to Srimadi Nisha, my Sevak, and also Mr. Sunil Kumar and Vijayan, who have worked as office assistants at my residence. I felt safe and comfortable while being chauffeured by Sri V.C. Bijesh, who has been duly taking care of my personal affairs also with utmost sincerity. My personal security officers, Prem Kumar and Manilal, have been ensuring my safety and security diligently. I am indebted to all of them for enabling me to work and live all throughout without any sense of insecurity. I sincerely thank Srimadi Gita, my part-time super, who, apart from her routine jobs, had been taking care of my health also voluntarily as and when required. My sincere thanks are due to Srimadi Sophie Thomas, Registrar General, and the entire team of registrars and all other officers to the registry, Sri Johnny Sebastian, the director of KSMCC, and staff of KSMCC, and also to Sri Nisar Ahmed, member secretary Kalsa. I am grateful to Sri R. Ashok, protocol officer, and his team in the protocol wing. My thanks are due to Srimadi V. Deepa, the chief librarian, Sri T.S. Arun, public relations officer, and Sri Sri Kumar, assistant engineer, electrical, and the team under him. I am grateful to the entire IT team for the timely help rendered for the conduct of hassle-free video conferencing proceedings. I thank Sri Rajendran Pillai, the listing court officer, the lift operators and all other officers and members of the staff of the High Court who have helped me in my judicial and administrative work. I am grateful to Sri Shajuka Varghese, the Chief Security Officer, and all the members of the police force who were engaged for my protection. I also thank Dr. Kishore for the prompt medical attention. I would also acknowledge with gratitude the support I received from all those who were and are in the apartment complex. The selfless service rendered by each and every member of the staff in the war room e-filing COVID, which alone made the functioning of this court possible in the difficult times without break since last year, deserves special appreciation. I thank the learned members of the illustrious bar for the cooperation extended to me. Without active contributions from the advocates on either side, it would not be easy to render a judgment. The credit for good judgments are due to the lawyers who argued their cases with the apt and relevant supporting materials, apart from their well-drafted pleadings. I profusely thank each and every counsel and the law officers of both center and state whose contributions helped me a lot in arriving at my decisions. I request the young members of the bar to strive hard to maintain and uphold the dignity of the profession as well as the tradition of the Kerala High Court Bar. The district judiciary of our state has always been at the forefront because of the commitment and hard work of officers from time to time. I wish all the judicial officers every success in fulfilling their responsibility to upkeep that reputation with flying colors. Before concluding, it would be relevant to state that destiny made me the second woman in the state who got elevated from the bar, which happened after an interval of 23 years. Even though the third woman from the bar got elevated within a period of 11 months, the total number of women judges from the bar continues to be 3 only, even after about 64 years of the establishment of this court. It is understood that recommendation is pending now. Let me hope they would be able to join at the earliest and would be followed by further fruitful recommendations without much time lag, as erudite and competent young women dedicated to the profession who are smart enough to outbid their counterparts are available in the bar in abundance. At this juncture, with pranams to my late father and uncle, I thank my mother and siblings as well as my teachers for all their contributions to my life. I am fortunate to have a group of friends who stood with me all along and have always been a source of strength to me. I would never be able to forget them. Now it is time for me to bid adieu. Indeed, I am sad, not because I am demitting office, but I am being deprived of the premises where I spent more than half of my lifetime, major part as a lawyer and 7 years as a judge. Apart from the canopy and chirping birds of Mangalavanam and the backwaters a little farther, which amused me at my lunchtime in the chamber for the last 7 years, I will miss the air and the entire vicinage from where I had been breathing for the last 3 decades in the profession. I would cherish all these in my fond memories. I thank each and every one of you again and wish you all the very best, especially for overcoming the present crisis created by the pandemic. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Major. May I now please invite Honorable Mr. Justice P. Suthitra Kumar for reply speech.
My dear Chief Justice, Honorable Mr. My esteemed brother and sister judges, distinguished former judges of this court, the learned Advocate General Mr. K. Gopalakrishna Kurup, the President of the Kerala High Court Advocates Association Mr. Thomas Abraham, the Assistant Solicitor General of India Mr. P. Vijayakumar, Additional Advocate General Mr. K. K. Rabindranath, the Director General of Prosecution Mr. T. A. Shaji, the Additional Director General of Prosecution Mr. Suresh Babu Thomas, the State Attorney Mr. K. V. Sohan, the Law Officers of the Centre and the State, Chairman of the Bar Council of Kerala Mr. Joseph John, President of the Kerala Federation of Women Lawyers Srimadi S. K. Devi, President of the Senior Advocates Association Mr. N. N. Sugunabalan, the esteemed members of the legal fraternity, the Registrar General and other registrars of the High Court, the judicial officers, the staff members of the High Court, advocates clerks, my family members who are present here, friends and all those who are attending this function on virtual mode and otherwise. I am overwhelmed by the good words spoken to about me by the Honorable the Chief Justice, the Learned Advocate General and the Learned President of the Bar Association, and I must with all humility express my sincere thanks. I had a very humble beginning in the legal profession. Being a first generation lawyer, I had to struggle hard to make my mark in the profession after my enrollment as an advocate. While so, I had the opportunity to join the Higher Judicial Service as a district judge on 1/12/2001. After completing the service of 13 years and 5 months in the Higher Judicial Service, I was elevated as the judge of this Temple of Justice on 10/4/2015 by the grace of the Almighty. I will lay down my office As a judge of this court on 30/5/2021, after serving this institution for a period of more than 6 years and 1.5 months, with a feeling of pride and satisfaction that I could discharge my divine duties of dispensation of justice to the best of my ability and conscience. The bar is the best judge of a judge. Now it is time for the bar to judge whether I could fulfill the oath I made when the then Chief Justice of this honorable court, Mr. Justice Ashok Bhushan, who is presently a judge of the Honorable Supreme Court, administered the oath of office to me in its letter and spirit. In this occasion of emotion, I am less privileged to have my parents with me. They had to sacrifice a lot for my upbringing and to maintain me until I graduated as a lawyer. I am sure that tears of satisfaction would roll down their cheeks, and I feel their blessings in this occasion. When I graduated in law from the Government Law College, Ernakulam, my weak possession was certain abstract concepts of law. It was my stint with my senior, Advocate P. Jacob Varghese, now no more, that my minimal skill got sharpened so as to mature myself as a lawyer with self-respect. In this occasion, I bow before my most beloved and revered senior. I fondly remember the encouragement and the recognition offered to me by the Honorable Mr. Justice K.T. Thomas and the Honorable Mr. Justice B.M. Tulasidas when I was a novice in the legal profession. I deem it a fortune and recognition in getting an opportunity to preside in the Registrar's Court of the Apex Court. Then the then Chief Justice of India, Honorable Justice Y.K. Subrabal, now no more, had extended complete support and had all appreciation to me, which he had expressed unhesitantly. My Lord's love and affection will always be a fervent remembrance in my heart. I was fortunate enough to get the love, affection, and recognition from the Chief Justice of this court, Chief Justices of this court with whom I had occasion to work. Indeed, I deem it a proud privilege and fortune to have a Chief Justice like Honorable Mr. Justice S. Manikumar. His Lordship had been always keen to tap my service in the areas of my expertise and to encourage and support me whenever I required. With reverence and respect, I thank you, sir, from the bottom of my heart. I recollect with gratitude the appreciation and concern showered upon me by the Honorable Mr. Justice Ashok Bhushan, the Honorable Mr. Justice K.M. Joseph, the Honorable Mr. Justice Rishi H. Roy, the Honorable Mr. Justice K.G. Balakrishnan, the Honorable Mr. Justice R.V. Rabindran, the Honorable Mr. Justice Sri Joseph, the Honorable Mr. Justice K.S. Radhakrishnan, the Honorable Mr. Justice Kurian Joseph, the Honorable Mr. Justice J.B. Koshi, the Honorable Mr. Justice Payasi Kuriakos, the Honorable Mr. Justice Thottathil B. Radhakrishnan, and the Honorable Mr. Justice Veer Ram Kumar at various stages of my career in the judiciary. I remember with gratitude that I have received abundant support from all my colleagues in the High Court. I could develop quick intimacy with the judicial officers in the state with whom I had occasion to work, and they reciprocated in equal scale. I remember with gratitude the love and affection and the cooperation received by me from the judicial officers of the district judiciary at all the court centers where I had worked. It deserves special appreciation that the judicial officers of the district judiciary are tailing themselves to catch up the mounting arrears of judicial work without any complaint and without compromising the quality. I received a splendid cooperation from all the members of the staff in the district judiciary in all the court centers where I had occasion to work, without which I could not have comfortably discharged my duties to my satisfaction. I express my deep gratitude for the support and cooperation extended to me by the judicial officers and the staff members of the district judiciary, and I assure them that I shall always remember them with much affection. I place on record my sincere appreciation for the support and cooperation extended to me by the lawyers of this court and the other court senders, without which I could not have performed my duties effectively. The words are inadequate to express my appreciation to all the members of the Bar Associations in this regard. Your love and affection will remain in my heart forever. The Registrar General Srimati Sophie Thomas and the Registrars of the High Court deserve appreciation for the support and cooperation extended to me for the discharge of my duties as a judge of this court. I deeply appreciate the services rendered by the Public Relations Officer Sri T.S. Arun, the Protocol Officer Sri R. Ashok, the Chief Librarian Srimati Deepa V, and the Vehicle Superintendent Sri K.C. Srinivas. They were prompt, loyal, and efficient in discharging their duties. I also acknowledge the dedicated services rendered by the offices of the Accounts Section, A Section, and the Judicial and the Administrative Sections of the High Court. I also place on record the sincerity and dedication shown to me by the Security Officer Sri Shaju K. Varghese in discharging the duties. Though it is customary on the occasion like this to acknowledge the services rendered by the personal staff, I am doing the same as a reflection from my heart. My private secretary, Srimati Baby Anita PK, has served me with a deep sense of loyalty and sincerity. My court officers, Srimati Shepna KS, Mr. Felix John, Srimati Sudhi U, Srimati Sheba, Srimati Priya S. Nair, Sri Dilip Kumar, and Srimati Mary Anita were all competent, dedicated, and efficient in discharging their duties well. My personal assistants, namely Srimati Dixie Lasser, Srimati Subida TK, Srimati Reshma Karthi, Srimati Neetu KR, and Srimati Simi CL are all trustworthy, active, and hardworking. The coordination of all the above said offices made my task easy, quick, and perfect. I place on record my full appreciation to my escort Sri Ramakrishnan E and Sri Babu P and the office attendants Ramesan B, Srimati Rama Devi, Srimati Moli Annamma, Srimati Sukha Girish, my sevak Sri Raj and the part-time sweeper Srimati Vinita for their sincerity and commitment in discharging their duties. I also place on record the services rendered by my personal security officers, Sebastian K.A. and Subish V.D., and the chauffeurs, Sri Manoj D., Sri Bijumon, Anil T.R., Benson, Vinod, and Sri Shanil. I also acknowledge the sincere, prompt, and dedicated services rendered by the lift operators, court keepers, civil surgeons, and the feathers of the High Court. The duke's clerks play a very important role in the smooth functioning of the judiciary, and I acknowledge their valuable services to the system. By the grace of God, I reached this exalted position, which is the highest position I could aspire for. I am happy that I received more than what I desired by the grace of God and the blessings of my parents, gurus, and elders. Before parting, may I share a thought which surfaces in my mind. As we are aware, the constitutional vision in Article 51AJ provides that it shall be the duty of every citizen of India to strive towards excellence in all spheres of individual and collective activity so that the nation constantly rises to higher levels of endeavor and achievement. This is all the more important in the legal profession. As it is usually said with reference to the Constitution that the law should be dynamic so as to cater to the varying needs of the society from time to time, a legal position, settled as it may appear, may require reconsideration at a later point of time, depending upon the values enshrined by the society. The legal system should be vibrant enough to recognize, appreciate, and uphold such changing needs of the society in consonance with the constitutional provisions and the laws. My beloved classmate, Honorable Mrs. Justice P.B. Asha, also lays down the office as a judge of this court along with me. I wish my esteemed sister the best in life. May the God bless her abundantly. I wish all success and prosperity to one and all connected with this temple of justice. Jai Hind.
Thank you, my lord. Reference proceedings have come to an end.